welcome to episode 2 of the Sharp Dojo Series from the SWN Podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy, as I speak to people that have been nominated by Looking Sharp of the Looking Sharp Online Dojo. I am joined this week by the inevitable Stone Malone. Welcome back to the show.
Thanks for having me again.
Yes, we were saying beforehand, when Lou nominated you, you're the first person to be on the SWN podcast, the Untitled podcast by SWN, and now the Sharp Dojo series. So you're now the triple crown champion of SWN, I guess we can, it's fair to say. Put that on the CV. I did listen to our last podcast because I didn't want to like go over the same things again. So if you want to find out how Stone got into pro wrestling, you can go check our previous episode, because that's when they'll be told. What have you been up to? Last time I spoke to you, it was for the Untitled one. We didn't really get to chat that much because we didn't have a lot of time. But what have you been up to in the last 5 months since our last proper podcast chat?
Just the usual stuff, really. Like, trying to keep myself active, whether it's doing Twitch streams or going out walks, trying to find new ways to exercise, just trying to find anything that I can do so that I'm not just lying in bed all day just thinking about what I'm going to have for dinner.
Yeah, that's pretty much my bit at the moment. I've actually went into a new stage of lockdown where I'm actually cooking food. Like, usually it's my wife who does it, or if I'm doing it, it's something really easy, throw in the oven. But yeah, last night I was like, I really fancy chicken stuffed with Philadelphia, wrapped in bacon. I really fancy that. Oh, I'll make it myself. Who am I? It's disgusting. It was amazing. But it's disgusting that I've turned into this person. So what were your thoughts on our second podcast winner to come back to the show? The first one will go out because Ian Skirrer's episode is like way in the future and it is an absolute chaotic mess. But you won the best Untitled episode in our SWN podcast. Why do you think people voted for you?
I honestly think it might be to do with the story about Jerry. I feel like that was really underrated, like Christmas story wise.
It was the clincher.
Between that and also the quiz, I mean, the quiz was really entertaining as well.
I know. I'm like on the fence about bringing it back for next year, just because Zoom is so restrictive for times. But I'm going to have a wee dabble in Skype and see if we can bring back the quiz properly, and we can get a proper thing going. Get yourself in Brent for part two, and one of you can revenge the other's loss from last time. You're still twitching, obviously. Yeah. Doing Twitch TV, not the physical act of twitching. You've been doing Days Gone, is that right? Is how you find doing Twitch?
It's all right. Like, it's a struggle of trying to find games that will attract viewers, because there are certain games that I enjoy and then there's certain games that like other viewers but find like boring to watch. Like, for example, Days Gone, like, I enjoy playing it, but a lot of people that watch my streams, they were saying to me that it's kind of hard sometimes because it's like kind of a slow game. But like when the action's there, it's really good. But if I stream for about an hour and like maybe 70% of it is mostly story and traveling, they tend to find it like really boring. So it's just trying to find the games that will attract viewers and keep them hooked.
Yeah, I was finding that when I was dabbling in stream. That, and I didn't really want to speak to folk. I just wanted to play in peace. But I was like, oh, I'll put it on Twitch, see how that goes. And then eventually I was just like, nah, I'd rather be left to myself, dying constantly without having to interact with other people while I'm just getting furious about dying every 2 seconds. But yeah, anything else? I know you're a big DC Marvel fan. What are your thoughts on the Snyder Cut?
I'm looking forward to it, but at the same time, I'm also not looking forward to it being 4 hours long. Like, the trailer that I've seen make me want to watch it, but knowing that it will literally be a 4-hour watch is kind of soul destroying.
Especially if it's shit.
Exactly. Like, I mean, that's something I've noticed DC are very famous for. Like, the trailer for a film comes out and it looks amazing, and then you see the film itself and it is shit.
It's like, I mean, Endgame, was it Endgame? Or, yeah, Endgame was 3 hours long, but at least Marvel had built up the trust in 10 years to know it's at least going to be some sort of entertaining for that amount of time. Do you find that DC just tried to, like, rush Justice League too quickly? Because, like I say, Marvel had a bunch of films before they did the first team-up one, whereas DC had Man of Steel and Batman. Or, no, they didn't have that. Man of Steel. They went, all right, they're all together now.
I did think they did rush it, like, because I remember seeing, like, the Flash series and thinking, right, it's going to be him that'll be tying into the Justice League film, but when I saw that it was, like, a completely different Flash, I was a wee bit confused, and I don't know what it is that DC tried to do, but, like, the first Justice League just, pardon the pun, it didn't do any of the heroes in the film justice, but the Snyder Cut could do them some justice, but it's that way, we'll need to wait till the film actually comes out.
Yeah, I'm in the same kind of boat. I'm intrigued, but yeah, I don't want to sit for 4 hours for something that will take 3 hours to get somewhere and then go, let's do something totally different for the last hour. But who knows, maybe I'll find a copy. Hopefully I'll actually have the whole copy when I find it this time and not the last 10 minutes cut off. Have you been watching WandaVision?
I did, yeah. I've watched it. Well, yeah, like every Friday the new episodes came out, I was on top of it, and there were some theories that I had that didn't come true, and I applauded Marvel for that because they kept fans on the edge of their seat, like, is this going to happen? Like, what's happening next? So, I think the series was really great.
Were you on the Mephisto train? Sorry, for anyone watching this, there may be some spoilers. I should say that now.
Yeah, I was kind of on the Mephisto train, but the train I was mostly on was the Mr. Fantastic train. I really expected him to make an appearance.
Yeah, I was kind of sitting in the last one. I mean, as of recording, who knows? One may drop tomorrow out of nowhere. But yeah, I was like, oh, it's going to be a big cameo at the end. Is it going to be Mr. Fantastic? Is it going to be Doctor Strange? Is it going to be Banner? It was none. None of them at all. Paul Bettany pulled off the greatest troll by saying that an actor he wanted to work with most turned out, spoilers, was himself.
Yeah, I mean, you can't even be mad.
I know, it's one of those things, going on to Reddit every Friday just to get the theories, because we discussed last time, I wasn't a big comic book guy. I'll read a couple, but I don't know the lore, I just know bits and pieces. So when people were throwing out all these names, I was like, that sounds interesting. So for me, when I saw the end of it, I was like, this is all wrapped up quite nicely. Cool. Ooh, this could be Doctor Strange, tying Doctor Strange. But yeah, people go nuts for, like, Nightmare and Mephisto and all that kind of stuff. I'm just there going, aye, could be. Don't know. Let me just enjoy the ride. So we've got Falcon and Winter Soldier next.
Oh, I'm looking forward to that.
Yeah, I think that
be slightly better than WandaVision, but that might just be because I'm really biased when it comes to Captain America.
I know. I'm waiting for the Friday theories going, oh, that could, Captain America's going to turn up. And just to go, oh, no, he's not. They folk are going to maybe be a bit calmer this time with their theories, knowing that Marvel have, they know their audience far too well. And we'll be able to just to play them like a fiddle. for this. Yeah, I was watching the like the Legends things on Disney Plus, like the wee 10-minute catch up where the, how the characters got there, and yeah, super excited for where that's going to go. Right, let's go to some wrestling chat, because folk will be listening to this thinking it's going to be a wrestling chat. I was spent the first 10 minutes speaking about anything but. As you've been, last time we spoke was 5 months ago when we recorded in October, and then we did the quiz, which I said doesn't really count because we didn't really get that much chatting. You've been quite busy with the old promos, I've been noticing. You've been promoing for, what we've got here? We've got Target Heavyweight Championship. They were doing a big thing. So is that something you've been aiming to work towards your promos, or is it something you're just trying to just get out to get your name out as soon as possible?
It's something I've like tried to work on. So like some promos I'll record maybe like 5 to 10 takings just to see what one I think would work better. And then like if I've got one that I'm happy with, I'll delete the rest and either post that promo or send it to the promotion that's looking for said promos.
It's always the same. It's either going to be one take or it's going to be a load of takes. I did a little bit for Kurt Cooper's Hitting the Headlines podcast. It was like not even 2 minutes, knocked out one go. That was my pen. I knocked out one go, great. And then same time, like just before I chatted to yourself, I did a 30-second video for Monday Night Chores, and it took me fucking ages. It took me like, it was 5 attempts, and I was like, that's the one I've stuttered the least on. That can go. That's the one that's being sent over. So Target is, they've offered a spot. I think they're doing a like and share thing to get people possibly going. I'm not sure how they're working their thing. But you've also been announced for Pro 2 as well, Pro 2 Championship Wrestling. Of course, run by Logan Storm. What was your process getting into there? Was it a CV, or how did you get involved with Pro 2?
Kind of a simple process. Like Logan basically just asked me if I was pro two, and I said fucking absolutely, because like I knew I'd seen him like promoting pro two before like assigning a roster, so like I had a rough idea what it was when he messaged me about it, and then when he messaged me, I was like yes, absolutely, and then. He's assigned me to the Joker division, I believe. So I'm really looking forward to competing in that and wrestling along everyone else that will be a part of that division.
The roster is just ridiculous. Can't believe that it's just so stacked already. I've spoken to Logan, which an episode that's coming out in the future, and he seems to, if he's asked you to be involved, he's already got a story in mind for you. Or he's got like a plan, or he knows kind of where you're going or how you use. Has he kind of, I don't want to know what the plans are, but has he kind of already pitched you some stories for what he plans to do with you?
Yeah, like, without trying to spoil too much, like, he's run a couple of ideas by me, and every one of them has, like, been really interesting. So I don't know if he is going to run every one of them, like, one story will play into the other, etc., or if he's just, like, these are ideas, and then he'll go, right, that one will work at this moment in time. So it's just that way, like, waiting to see what does happen. But I'm really looking forward to working for Pro 2 and seeing where it goes.
Absolutely. And another place you've been eyeing up is TNT Extreme. They've got a tournament for their Ignition Championship, if I'm right in thinking that. And also British Wrestling Revolution, a Youth in Revolt tournament as well. So, again, it's just finding opportunities and trying to get your name in there.
Pretty much. I've just seen opportunities, and I've gave them a retweet of what the gif I usually go with, the guy going, I would like to do that, please. And then after retweeting that, I would message the promotion and ask if it would be okay to send them my CV, just so they can see... Like, I'm not a slouch who's just chancing my arm here. like I actually do have like a bit of experience, so it's that way. If they like what they see in the CV, hopefully they bring me down. So
I was kind of concerned when I saw people doing these gifts, thinking, are they just doing a gift and that's it? So it's, I'm happy to hear that at least, well, yourself, that's going, I've done this little funny bit, and then I'm going to go, aye, but I actually want to be in it. So here's my stuff. And let me know as soon as possible. Is that the sort of thing you've been picking up at the dojo?
Kind of, aye. Like, the first class was like the CV class, so I learned a lot from that because, I mean, my first CV, like, it was very basic. It was like an introduction to who I was, what styles I could wrestle, promo pick here, here's a match there. Like, it's one of the things, like, some promoters would look at it and just be like, just another CV. But now, like, learning for that class and every other, and then all the guests that Lou has brought on, like, they've spoke about CVs at point as well, like, things to put on it, and then other ways to, like, promote yourself on social media. So I've really learned a lot from that.
Yeah, I mean, wrestling's really evolved from just being a handshake going, oh yeah, we'll get you on a month or so, to now being, you know, CV, I want your music, I want your promos, I want everything, so that, yeah, that I'm putting out the best product and that you're getting the best opportunities as well. So yeah, the CV one, of course, I was there for the tag team one with Krieger, which is also something that you'll be interested in as well, because you're teaming with Uniraw. And then you had the Selena De La Renta one, a producer for MLW. So what was that one like? Because that's more about how to more production and how to get involved. What was that, her class like?
So like, it was basically, it was like how to put yourself out there and make yourself stand out, because like, she told her story and how she made it in wrestling, and like, she basically has the same philosophy to everything. Like, always have stuff prepared, have like your CV prepared, have your gear prepared, have everything prepared, and if there's shows going on around you but you're not booked on them, ask the promoter to come down and help out, like with a ring, or if they need somebody there to like maybe do security or something like that, just ask for like if they need assistance, and if they say yeah, then go down, help them, because then that's you getting in the eye of a promoter who sees somebody who's willing to put the work in to then be rewarded with a chance of a possible booking.
Yeah, that's pretty much what I've been kind of hearing. It's like nowadays, it's not just always bring your gear. It's like it's always have a link to a match, or always have a link to a promo as well. So you've had a fair few matches now. What would say your top, I don't know, three that you'd include in that CV? What would be the ones that you're most proud of?
Well, the first one I would send would be my one with Liam Thompson. Like, because, well, it's Liam Thompson. So, and I feel like it's probably been my best singles match in my career so far. Another match I would send would be the six-man tag I was involved in for the PWS and PWI Super Show. It was me, Ewan O'Raw, Darren Weiss against Hal Rayner, Owen Jacks, who's what now known as Jimmy Pierce, I believe, and Danny Edwards. So, like, I'd send that match in. And then a third one, I'm not really sure, because like a lot of the footage I have is tag matches. So like I would send in another tag match that would just mean, you know, all against Fortune 500. I would send that in as well, because I feel like that was a really good match, considering it was a promotion we never really worked for before.
Of course, yeah, down Dundee. I mean, I suppose as well, tag matches are a bit more complicated because generally you're the bigger of the two, height and a bit more stockier as well than you. And so he'll be the one that's doing the majority of the beating, of getting beat down, and you're the one that's coming in and flinging folk about. So it's a bit weirder dynamic. But Definitely that Krieger tag seminar was, I've said it in other podcasts coming up, but it's weird. I've listened to that. I wrote notes for matches I'll never have, but I wrote notes and I ended up watching a tag match the night after and watching it going, I'm seeing the psychology that I never really paid much attention to.
It's weird how that happens. Like, you write something down, like, right, okay, I'm going to focus on this, and then you study a match, and then you're like, oh, aye. Like, they've either done it, or then sometimes they'll not do something, and you'll be like, should have done that there. Like, it's really weird how when somebody says something to you and you take a note of it, you just notice it immediately.
Yeah, it's so weird. It was America's Most Wanted against 3 Live Crew. So, of course, it's got four hugely experienced wrestlers at the same time and tag team wrestlers. But, yeah, I just couldn't believe when I was watching going, oh, that's what Krieger said. I said that as well. And that's them doing it. Of course, they've got some huge guests coming up. Unbelievable guests. So, for those that are unaware that listen to this, this is going to come out like 2 days after I've recorded it. So, It's recent. It's not like I'm recording it October and putting out November like last time we chatted. But we've got Just Incredible, Bull James, and Hector Guerrero, the gobbledygooker himself. So is there any ones that Buffa as well, of course, Big Buffa. Is there any particular classes that you're intrigued by to get involved in listening and watching?
Definitely, I'm really interested in all four of them, but if I had to single out one in particular that I was really looking forward to, I'd probably say Hector Guerrero, purely because, well, I mean, he's from the Guerrero family, but that stands for itself. So, like, his wrestling knowledge is going to be, like, at the top. And, like, you'll just have so much other information that you can pass on, like, stuff on how you make yourself stand out, get yourself out there. Like, that's what I like about learning for you guys like this. It's not like you're just learning wrestling from them. Like, you're learning the business from them. And that's what I really like about these online classes.
That's it. Yeah, I mean, wrestling itself, the wrestling's almost secondary. If you can get the story and yourself, like, over, so to speak. I hate using wrestling terminology, but that was the only word I could think of at the time. But as long as the crowd's invested, then the wrestling's almost a second part of it. And of course, Hector Guerrero, I mean, a lot of people will remember him, of course, as the gobbledygooker, but my favourite Hector Guerrero was TNA, where he was with LAX.
Mm-hmm. That was the first
time
I really knew who he was, because
like,
I was a young guy at the time, and then, like, it was weird, I never heard the name getting announced, but I'm looking at him like, he looks like Eddie Guerrero. And then that's when I heard when the commentators say, and Hector Guerrero is now getting into the ring, I'm like, that makes so much sense now. And then, like, from there, I've just, like, went back and watched a lot of the stuff, like, with him and Eddie, either teaming up or against each other, and learning stuff like that.
Yeah, it's one of those guys that's definitely worth going back and checking his career, because he's phenomenal. I mean, it's a Guerrero. I mean, even by 2004, Chavo Classic, Chavo Guerrero Sr. was still being able to shift, even though he didn't look like he could. He was still being able to put on matches with likes of Rey Mysterio. So the Guerrero line is just ridiculous. And of course, is carried on by his other son, Dominic. To 2005, people, if you want to go back and watch, find out why I said that. One story I missed when we were chatting before, I don't know if I said it afterwards, but, and I'm hoping that I've just not mixed you up with someone else. A video went round of you doing your entrance to nobody. So, yeah. So this was a rib, obviously. Oh, excuse me using more wrestling terminology. But how without mentioning, you don't have to mention any names, who made you do it. But what were your thoughts as you were coerced into doing that?
Oh, like, I went into it basically like, don't give a fuck. Like, I remember one time, like, people were talking about who to rib, and Krieger said, Stone's a hard one to rib, because, like, I'll admit it, I'm quite gullible, and, like, Krieger said that as well, but then he also said, he also doesn't give a fuck. So it's that way, like, if it entertains people, even if it makes a mockery of me, I'll happily do it. Anything to make people laugh. So that's my mentality. If you've got happy people beside you, then you're going to have a good time.
I think as well, it was quite good that you're doing it as the face, because it was just come on and clapping. I have a feeling that if you were told to come out as a heel to do that, you would have looked like it would have looked a bit stupid coming out and scowling to nothing.
I did do it as a heel, but that just went distorted. So basically, I just walked around going like, nobody. And then that's when I've done it as a face, and that got recorded.
Nobody other than those in that hall will have known, and will have seen that happened the first take. So you said you're quite hard to crack because you just don't give a fuck. Was there any other attempts anyone's tried to get you?
Not really. Like, I'd honestly say Krieger's the one who gets me the most, because, like, I'm assuming you've heard of the wrestling license rib now.
Yes, I've made several now, just due to this joke.
He initiated me with that. Like, he's heard it on a podcast, and he figured he would try it out, and I became the victim. And Krieger's that way. He'll make you believe anything he says. Like, he's just got one of the faces and voices that he can string you the stupidest story, but it's so believable. And he told me this on the way to a show, and I was like, oh, fuck, what am I going to do? And then he's like, you better go and ask TJ what to do. So, of course, I went and asked him, and then when TJ said, a wit, I was like, oh, you fucking...
speaking of the wrestling license, because I made one for a good friend of yours recently, Mr. A.A. Ron Chalmers.
Oh, hi, him.
Who is A.A. Ron Chalmers?
So, to anyone that doesn't know, he's famous for being on Jordy's show, and then when that show became irrelevant, he turned into an MMA fighter. And I don't know how he does with that. Like, I've never watched any of his fights, but I've had people like tell me what his record is now, and he seems to be doing okay with it. But I mean, going from Jordy Shore to MMA now, believing that he's going into WWE, like, oh my god, it makes me laugh every time.
And of course he did reply to you. What did he say? He's gonna retire by the time he's 40.
Aye, basically, he'll be in and out of WWE before they phone me. But like, the one thing I really noticed by his reply was when he said, check the clip of you. And like, I went onto my timeline and I was scrolling through like, what clip? Thinking there was like a video somewhere, and then I asked somebody, like, here, what does that mean? And then, like, they told me it was the job, the equivalent to check the state of you. I was like, all right, okay, that makes sense now.
Was there a bit of the back of your mind that you actually did a proper search and found your YouTube channel was going, watching his matches, watch match with Liam Thompson, going, all right, okay, maybe. but yeah, it's... I don't understand why he thinks that's a good thing, that he'd be in and out by the time he's 40. Does that mean he's shite and he's been released?
Fuck those, because like, he was on Jordy Shore when I was still in school, so like, I've no idea how old he is. I've had to guess, I'd say roughly mid-30s, but I could be completely wrong and he may have been on TV at a really young age, but... Fuck knows, man. Fuck knows what you're getting yourself into.
I mean, it's... If you look at the people that have also went from acting to MMA careers, you've got the guy from Harry Potter as well, so and of course the Green Power Ranger. So it's a very eclectic mix of famous folk. Although I'd CM Punk, of course, going into all these things. So interesting. We'll leave it at that. So I did promise that we've got a game that we're going to play today before we continue. I've got I realised I didn't actually ask you the dinosaur question last time, so I'm saving that for later. But we've got a game that's called Wrestle Tag Bury. Mm-hmm. And that was the brief pause there for the wee intro, because I made a wee intro 10 seconds long. So there's three names, very easy. One wrestle, one you tag with, one you bury, which is the equivalent to kill. I didn't want to put kill because it sounded a bit creepy. I've got three rounds, two silly rounds, one you might actually have a bit more thought with. So, first round, wrestle, tag, bury. Martin Stone, Robert Stone, Stone Cold Steve Austin.
Wrestle Martin Stone, tag with Stone Cold Steve Austin, bury Robert Stone.
I did have a think that was going to be the answer. I wasn't sure about Martin or Stone Cold. I thought that might kind of flip a little bit.
Yeah, one that I was really thinking of.
Round two, this might be a bit more difficult. Rockstar Spud, The Rock, Brock Lesnar.
Ooh. Now, wrestle Brock Lesnar, tag with Rockstar Spud and bury The Rock.
Oh, controversial. Why?
Yeah. I don't know. I feel like The Rock's, like, he's not really focused on wrestling now. Like, he's a very successful actor now, so like, it's that way. Like, I suppose I couldn't really bury him. Like, there's no burying The Rock, but like, if I had the choice to like avoid one of them in wrestling, it'd probably be The Rock, purely because he doesn't really need the wrestling anymore.
I'd just stick backstage on one of these cheat meal days with some Terramana and tequila and just go wild.
Still want to try some of that.
Yeah, me too, but it's like I think there's a Crafty Connoisseur has some, but they're just because they just have to import it, it's just crazy prices.
Yeah,
I'm not a tequila drinker myself, but I'm so intrigued to give it a go at the same time.
Really, because it's The Rock's own tequila.
Absolutely. It's the same with Dos Hombres. I think it's Bryan Cranston and Aaron Paul's. I'm just like, I don't like tequila, but I kind of want to try that because it's the Breaking Bad tequila.
Exactly. One of the things.
And our last one, we've got, this is probably the toughest one. So, Wrestle Tag, Barry, oh, I forgot the name of my own show. You and a Raw, Kreiger, TJ Rage. Softballed you for the first couple for the mineral puns, but got a thinker at the end.
Well, wrestle TJ Rage, because I've said before that's a match I'd really be interested in doing. Oh god.
It's like Sophie's Choice now.
Yeah. Right. Tag with you in a row and bury Kreiger because of the things he's rubbed me.
Oh, so let's hope he doesn't listen to this or watch it, but we should.
I'm prepared for the repercussions yet.
And the usual two stupid questions we have, and we'll go back to some wrestling chat, but their question is, what's your favourite dinosaur?
Lichosaurus.
Oh, nice. Great. I love it when people go outside of actual dinosaurs. great. Another one, which is a question you probably heard several times because it's come from Lou and Krieger themselves, but what would win in a fight, two sheep or one cow?
See, I reckon the two sheep.
Yes. Finally. Right. I think we're up to, I've asked about who knows how many people. I think we're up to three people that have now said sheep. So I'll believe it. I'll believe it. It's, do you think it's a strategy or just outnumbered?
A bit of both, because like one sheep could distract the cow and then the other one could come in from the side or from behind and just knock it in its arse.
Yeah, I've went for you can get a cow upstairs, but you can't get a cow downstairs. So they can, if they can get a cow upstairs, then the more I've said this theory now, the more stupid it sounds. But there has been other folk just out that can outwork a cow. The cow will give up. Or I think Logan Storm said a sheep, if it rams, its spine locks, so it would just tear through a cow. So we're learning. We're learning as we go with this ridiculous question, which everyone will be answering from about Looking Sharp's episode onwards. That's like next week. We've got weird questions in the Twitter. These are all, I mean, because we did that much wrestling chat in our last episode, this has been mostly just nonsense. But we've got Hal Rayner coming in with, if you make two lasagnas, then stack them one on top of the other, how many lasagnas do you have?
I think the answer to that would be just one big lasagna.
Yeah, I'm of that thought as well. Must be. I mean, it would have like a crispy cheese middle, which sounds amazing.
Oh, it does. Now you mention it.
I'm all for it.
Because I was thinking, would it be four? And then I'm like, no, because
it's still one lasagna. Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, if you cut it in half, then it's two lasagnas. But it's, if there's no cut, then it's still one.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's what we're going with. And Jason Hyde, what's your favourite type of wheel?
Wagon wheel.
Yes, that was my answer. As soon as I read it as well, I was like, if it's anything other than wagon wheel, then it's wrong. That's the one to go with. Right, okay, so another thing that you've been popping up recently, because of course I have to do a wee cyber stalk to get some notes and questions. You've professed a little bit of love for the SmackDown games again recently. I've got a couple behind me that you can't see because I've got the pops in the way, but I found them when I was going through some stuff. So I've got SmackDown versus Raw, Here Comes the Pain, Shut Your Mouth. What were your favourites? Any particular memories playing them?
Oh man, the first one I ever had was Here Comes the Pain, and I just remember like getting it on Christmas Day with like, my first PlayStation 2 and just sitting in my room like all night after the Christmas dinner with my cousins playing it, and it was a great time. But I'd say my favourite game for the SmackDown series would probably be Shut Your Mouth.
Honestly, I think that's an underrated gem. I think everyone goes Here Comes the Pain first of all, but Shut Your Mouth was my first one with the PS2 that I got for Christmas. So it was Shut Your Mouth, the one I played. Do you ever go back and, or at least think of your creations, your creative wrestlers and cringe or think, oh, I imagined I was going to be like that one day and now I'm nay?
Sometimes, yeah, but sometimes I would get really bored and make up these absolutely ridiculous like creations. I remember this one creation I made that was in the first SmackDown versus Raw game. I made him a blue skeleton and I gave him the hair of Paul Phoenix, and I can't even remember what his gear was, but I just remember giving him robot hands for some reason. And then like after a week of that, I decided, right, this guy needs a tag partner. So I copied and pasted him, but instead of a blue skeleton, I put a paper bag over his head. And I thought, well, there's your tag team. I didn't have a name for them. I just went with Default. Look, there you go.
See, I was always like, the one that keeps flashing back to my mind is when I was younger, I had hair, and I would get blonde streaks through it. So I made a character had a blonde streaked mohawk, like not even a mohawk. It was like you had hair and it was like gelled up.
The faux hawk.
Is that it? Something like that. Yeah. And the attire. I don't know why I was thinking. It was jean shorts because I liked wearing jean shorts. It's all well so far. Trainers, pulled up socks. Cause, so it's all good down below. A belt with a chain, because, you know, got to have a belt with a chain. A string vest, a black string vest. An earring, like a big earring. An eyebrow ring, didn't think I was ever going to get one of those. A goatee. I looked like I go clubbing by the power finish. And I thought I looked cool as fuck in this character. And that's what I used my season mode. And I would have fingerless gloves. And I have wraps all the way up as well. And I thought, oh, it looks so cool. And then, yeah, when I think about the card now, I look at it and go,
just to look back at it, like, oh, why did I think that was a good
play? Why did I think that was cool? Why did I? Yeah. In those games as well, it'd take ages to create someone because you could go online, you go to cause.ws, and you can find the plans to make anyone. And I spent a whole weekend making Charlie Hoss.
Oh, my God. Oh.
Anyone in the world. I had to print it out. So I had a stack of I don't know, what's it, 10 or 11 pages of codes.
You had to get like the skin tone, the eye shape, you had to get everything perfect. I remember I started with Rey Mysterio for Shut Your Mouth, because I remember unlocking your gear. I'm like, right, I actually need to make him in this game now, so I just looked up how to do it. And oh my god, I think I spent the full day on it. It was crazy.
I know, then you get to the end of it, you're just like, gotta be arsed using them now, I've spent that much time. But yeah, Charlie Hoss, why did I wait? I had a big folder of these codes as well. I don't know how much ink I used over that time, but kids these days, I could just go into community creations and someone's made one. We had to make it code by code. Absolutely useless. Right, so last time we spoke, when you were talking about like matches you wanted to do, matches you wanted to have, pretty much the answer was anything. But 5 months have passed now. Is there anyone more set you want to face? Anyone that, after doing all these promos and that, anyone that you've got your eye on for a match when shows return?
There's a good few, but one in particular is Scotty Rock.
Okay.
Like, because when he posted like a highlight reel saying that he missed like wrestling, I noticed it. Like, because Kurt Johansson had retweeted it, and I wrote a comment underneath it saying it's crazy how much I want to share a ring with this guy now. And Scotty himself had actually liked my reply, so I was thinking, like, oh, this could be something in the future. So, like, if that match was to ever happen, I'd be really happy with that.
That's the thing with with Kurt as well. Kurt's great for just trying to get information everywhere, because I've always been posting in the dojo as well. Have you found that since you joined the dojo that your networking's increased? Are you sending CVs everywhere, or have you been finding yourself more busy because of it?
Since joining the dojo, like, I've sent CVs out to companies in Denmark, promotions in Spain, and then, like, obviously some other ones down south that I've never really sent a CV to before. So just the waiting game now, really, to see if any of them are interested in using me. But definitely say, like, the networking
it
is, like, really paid off.
Yeah, that's what I've been finding with, I mean, even just as an outsider looking in, just how much, well, between, I said, like, what Lou's bringing in, and the fact that you are pro too. You've got guys like Krieger, of course, you've got TJ, who've got their own promotions, you've got Lou, who's got a hand at respect as well. So really, I was saying to Logan Storm, and I'll tell you now because the episode's not coming out for a couple of weeks, but he's created a opportunity pool, and he's brought you in involved as well. So he's a kind of created his own network that wrestlers like yourself can get involved in. So what would be your dream? You've put out your CVs. Is there any countries that you want to get to in particular, or ones like you have Denmark, Spain, and you just want to get to, or is there any ones you want to visit and actually wrestle in?
Basically, it's very cliche, but I definitely would love to travel the world to wrestle. Even if I need to go through every European country first, then I'll happily do it because I enjoy traveling as well. So if I do go over to Denmark for a show, I'm going to enjoy the traveling and I'm going to enjoy the experience of wrestling outside of Scotland, which is something I really want to give a go.
Your career itself, obviously no wrestling happened from last year. I think the last show was the 19th of March last year, which is was one of Grado's shows. So I don't know if you can count this as a year in career wise, but
I'm not.
So Lou also put out what's your goals? You wanted three small goals and a big goal. I can't remember what you put out of the top of my head, but what would be your what is your small goals, say, for the next 3-5 years, and what's your big goal, your final goal?
My small goals, both of them basically tie in each other. I want to get back into good shape. Before the lockdown, I'd say I was probably in the best shape in my life, but I still feel I could have been in better shape, and that was something I really wanted to work towards. So definitely that, and on top of that, I definitely want to get stronger so that way I can throw people around. So basically my two small goals tie into one medium goal, if you will, and that's just to get faster, better, stronger and better. And my big goal was to wrestle outside of Scotland, even if it's only in England. It's still wrestling outside of Scotland, and that's something I really want to push for, because I feel the more countries I wrestle in, the more my name's going to stand out when promos and get spread around.
Absolutely, and obviously you've taken steps that already with things like Target and TNT and BWR, so it's certainly putting in the work, and eventually you'll be able to face Aaron at WrestleMania, I'm sure.
Well, that's if he's mad enough to fucking step in the ring with me at one point.
That Aaron thing is now just, I can't look at the name Aaron anymore. And it's definitely a Key and Peele that it's the fault of it, because I can't, every time I look at it, I just go Aaron. And so, if Aaron Chalmers wants to go anywhere, he's really going to start changing his name, because he can't take it seriously. If he's going to go around, bloody Aaron.
Sure, you could hardly take him serious anyway. So,
I don't understand people. Settle yourself. You're on Georgie Shore. I'm sure everyone remembers your name. If you're not, I can't remember any of them. Charlotte Crosby, she was in Georgie Shore. That's it. That's all the ones I remember.
Yeah, pretty much. I never really watched it, so.
Right, so anything else you're looking forward to? Obviously, shows aren't happening. Hopefully, by the time this comes out, the gyms will be open again, or at least the opportunity to do sessions. So is there any places you're looking to get to do seminars? I know that the FPWA, of course, will be trying to do something as soon as, but is there anywhere any places you want to get to and get working?
Anywhere that does open, I spent the last year sitting in my arse, and I was looking into going to seminars, but I was that way. I was I really want to, because shows are not happening. I was beating myself mentally for it, but now I'm that way. It's if anywhere opens up, and even if it's a one-on-one session or anything. Like, I'm going to do what I can to put my name forward for it and hopefully get something booked in.
It's so weird that we're now at an age where we could do things like this. You could do seminars over Zoom and over Microsoft Teams, all that kind of stuff. I'm hoping that Lou, I mean, of course, he'll have his own wrestling to do once the show's open. He goes everywhere to do so, but I'm hoping he kind of keeps this running at least once a month, these Sharp Dojos, and because maybe you get people. I was looking just at the names on things like Sharps, like Lou's ones and FPWAs, and you get guys from my neck of the woods up in Aberdeen, then you get folk that are in Denmark, and it's just a nice melting pot of people to learn from. I think I've covered everything that I want to cover. Like I say, for anyone listening or watching this, we have spoken to Stone several times now because he is the only Triple Crown in SWN podcast history at this stage. But where can people find you on social media if they want to know more?
If you want to follow me on social media, you can find me on Twitter at StoneMalonePW, Instagram StoneMalonePW, and my Facebook as just StoneMalone.
Excellent. I noticed you wear some sponsored gear there, so even though we'll have our own sponsor plugs at the start, how do people get a hand on that snazzy SPRKIX t-shirt?
Oh, well, all you need to do is go on to the SPRKIX site and you can find this snazzy t-shirt, not just in this colour, but in multiple colours, as well as other snazzy gear, and you can purchase it with a discount code at STONE10.
It is that. I kind of wish I wore my SPRKIX one, but I would have clashed a little bit. thank you for joining me today.
It was a pleasure.
Hopefully, we'll do part two of the SWN podcast feed, I'm sure, by the end of the year at this rate.